Actually, I don't want to talk about the analogy. I want to talk how this analogy maybe help us to understand what happens in the real world, not in the world of the condensed matter, but in real gravity, in real quantum electrodynamics, and real black holes. Okay, but for that we need to consider we need to have the experience which we obtain from study of such condensed matter as liquid helium 2 and liquid and superfluid helium 3. One of them is a Fermi liquid, another is a Bose liquid, and they give us some hints in what direction we should move. Okay. Yes, I would not. I don't want to talk about all this. Just concentrate. So helium 3 is has many connections to practically all branches of physics, including, of course, cosmology, gravity, high energy physics, and also topological materials, because we have Weyl fermions in one of the phases, Majorana fermions in the other phase, and Dirac lines in the third phase, and so on. So practically all the branches of physics are connected. That's why I gave comments to almost every talk, because we had many experiments which were connected to the topic of the workshop. Okay, so idea is to construct the effective field theory for our universe, for so-called quantum gravity, for quantum electrodynamics, and so on. And at least we know how to do that in condensed matter. In condensed matter, it was Landau who introduced just two effective field theory. One of them is for superfluid helium 4. In terms of the two fluid hydrodynamics, and another one in terms of the Fermi liquid. So what he used is just three concepts. One of them is just quantum mechanics, which nobody understands, and me tomorrow also. And thermodynamics is the only theory of the universal character, and symmetry. And what was missing is topology. At that time, there was no very well-known methods of topological of ply topology. So let's start with the effective theory, which is of the hydrodynamic type, but from which we can say something a little bit about real gravity. So we have a doubt of fluid hydrodynamics, and I want to connect them in somehow, of course, it's not exact, with Einstein generally general relativity. So both from general point of view, already now it's clear that Einstein general relativity is effective theory. It's certainly effective theory because in general relativity the equations are in terms of the metric, but the fermions, real elementary particles, does not interact with metric; they interact with tetrad. That's why only tetrad relativity, tetrad general relativity, is a real is also effective theory, but it's more fundamental than Einstein theory. So what Landau started to do is just he considered the superfluid helium 4, the bosonic liquid, as the mixture of two liquids. One of them is the ground state, is a superfluid liquid, and another one is excitations. So we have, in terms of the excitations, there is a whole story about his first thought about what are the rotons, what are the phonons, but anyway, these are excitations above the ground state. So liquid, superfluid liquid, which moves the ground state, is a superfluid part of the system, and excitations, rotons, fermions, quasi-particles, the excitation above the ground state, above the vacuum. So we have the following connection. We have superfluid ground state plus elementary excitations, phonons and rotons. On the other side, we have our universe, where we have the vacuum. Vacuum is also very complicated structure, but it is the ground state of the system, plus elementary particles, which are rather few number in the present universe. So why it was possible to consider such situations that we have the ground state and the elementary particles, like here and here, is because now we have a very low temperature compared to the characteristic Planck scale. And that's why at low temperature excitations, there are not many excitations, they are dilute, and that's why we can really consider so the main part comes from the vacuum, and very small part comes from the elementary excitations. So elementary excitations in helium-4, this is just the speed of sound. And here it is a different elementary particle with the speed of light. If you start to excite the system, we find that instead of this simple spectrum, we will have just the spectrum in terms of the effective metric. I will show to you the effective metric, which comes, for example, from the flow. Originally, in a non-moving liquid, in non-moving superfluid, the phonon has a spectrum Cp. In the moving liquid, there is a Doppler shift. And please move this Doppler shift to the left, take square, and you obtain just g mu, p mu, p nu with the following metric, g not not, g not e, and so on. So all. In principle, it can be anisotropic, but here in helium-4 it is isotropic, in helium-3 it's anisotropic. So we have effective metric, and now we want to consider what is the effective space in which these particles move, these quasi-particles move. They move, for that we must take the inverse metric g-mu. The inverse metric g-mu produces the ds, which characterizes the effective space in which the interval in, of the effective space in which the particle moves. So for the moving liquid from this guy, we obtain that the interval just looks like that. So it is shifted by superfluid velocity. It means that the reference frame for phonons is dragged by the moving liquid. And now let's compare what happens in general relativity, for example, in case of the very simple black hole. For the black hole, this equation, I just open these brackets, and then you find that this equation looks like that. And this equation is actually the same as was introduced by Panlevy and Goldstrand to describe the black hole physics, where the velocity field is the square of the velocity field divided by two gives just the potential, gravitational potential of the body with mass m. So it's just corresponding to kinetic energy of the vacuum. If you make the transformation from this to the Schwarzschild metric, just simple transformation, you obtain the conventional form where v square is just this guy. Of course, there is a horizon when velocity when velocity of the flow of the vacuum, let's talk about the flow of the vacuum, exceeds the speed of light. It's better not to use this metric because this metric has singularity in the horizon. But the Panlevy-Goldstrand does not have the singularity here. You see singularity is divided by c square minus c square. This is infinity. But in Panlevy-Goldstrand metric, there is no singularity. And that's why we can consider what happens across the horizon. And across the horizon, the velocity of dragging exceeds the speed of light, and the particle cannot go outside. So what's called the horizon just corresponds to Landau criterion for when velocity field exceeds the speed of sound, then there are the excitations of the quasi-particle, and the excitation of the quasi-particle is just the Hodgkin radiation, which corresponds to just phonon and photon creation from the horizon. Okay. So what does it tell us? That we have two systems. One is general relativity, which describes it's an Einstein equation describes both the dynamics of metric, I mean the gravity, and simultaneously describes the dynamics of matter, because from this equation it immediately follows that there is a conservation law for the matter. In our case, instead of this equation, we have two equations. One of them is just for quasi-particle, which is exactly the same as for in general relativity. This is because it is obtained just using the effective metric. But the equation for the metric is more simple. It is just the conventional equation for the hydrodynamics. So these equations do not coincide. And of course, it's impossible that in quantum liquid you will obtain exactly the correct gravity. But I will show the next the situation when you can obtain this equation also. Okay. So is gravity fundamental? And the hint from the condensed matter that it's not, that we have some quantum vacuum, and at the low energy corner there appears the classical general relativity. Okay, now let's look how we can obtain the general relativity equations together with all the equations for the quantum fields and in our universe. So.
Yes. If this conjecture, the fundamental conjecture is correct, that the gravity is not the metal, but it's an emergent thing like helium or something. Basically, that there is no such a thing as quantum gravity at all. There's no point in talking about
quantum gravity is a different situation. Quantum gravity means that you what people consider. There are two types of quantum gravity. First, you start to quantize the Einstein equation. And this is okay on the level of the gravitons. So the gravitons can be obtained from quantization. But the deep level cannot be obtained by quantization. The same manner as from this equation, you cannot obtain the microscopic theory of helium-4 from low energy equations. So the quantum gravity, if it exists, it cannot be obtained by quantization of Einstein equations. This is the conclusion from condensed matter. Now, how to obtain now these equations using more complicated situation using topology. For that, we should consider the superfluid helium-3, actually the Landau-Fermi liquid. There are actually several universality classes of topological superfluids and normal liquids and metals, semi-metals and so on. Some of them, they have Fermi surfaces. Fermi surface is topologically stable. Another one has wild points or Dirac lines or Dirac points. So in helium-3, there are Dirac wild points. And near the wild points, one obtains gravity and the other things. OK. So first of all, it's important that we live at extremely low temperature, because the characteristic energy scale, it is a so-called Planck scale, it is G is a Newton constant, it is about 10 to 32 Kelvin. And we live at 200 Kelvin, and the highest energy in accelerator is 10 to power 16. So 16 is order difference between this scale. So we are at a very low energy, at a very low temperature at the moment. Moreover, our universe expands also extremely slow at the moment, because this is a Hubble law, and this Hubble constant is 10 to minus 60 of the Planck energy. So we are almost close to equilibrium. This means that we can use the Landau concept. We have very closed equilibrium, there are very small dilute amount of particles, and the problem is with this amount of particles. Okay. There is a characteristic energy scale, Planck scale. So what should be the mass of elementary particles in the medium, relativistic medium or non-relativistic medium with such scale? The mass should be of the order mc squared, should be order of the Planck scale. It means, it's natural. It means that this Boltzmann law shows to you that the number of particles in the present universe should be 10 to minus 10 to the 16. So it is zero in any units. And so this is a, there are two challenges. One of them is the cosmological constant, which I will talk about. And another one is much bigger challenge, is why we alive here? What is the reason for that? Why we are not frozen out completely? What is the reason that the mass of all our particles is extremely small compared to the Planck scale? Because it should be there is only one scale which is important, it's the Planck scale. So what happens? Why it is so? And also the cosmological constant, it should be of the order, huge order. Which is 220 order of magnitude, smaller than necessary from estimation. And we should find a solution for that. And momentum of soft topology just says that with a great accuracy, the mass of elementary particles is zero. We can forget about this small mass compared to this huge Pascal. And the same lambda should be very close to zero and not too close to the Planck scale. So what is the reason for that? The reason for that is that our vacuum contains the wild points and massless particles. And these wild points, they are topologically protected. And why is that topologically protected? Because they form the so-called hedgehog, which cannot be smoothly destroyed. So I will explain to you on this picture, for example. So this is ferromagnetic. In ferromagnets, the spin sigma is the hedgehog is along the radius. And there is a special winding number, which is unity, which shows that it's impossible to destroy this by any perturbation. So what can be done is just to have an anti-hedgehog and collide with the hedgehog. After that, the topological invariant 1 and minus 1, they annihilate each other. And the same happens actually in the momentum space for our elementary particles, quarks and leptons, neutrino, and so on, and electrons. Let's consider just the Hamiltonian, which describes the right-handed particle. The right-handed particle is plus C sigma dot P. So this is conventional 2 by 2 matrix for Weyl fermions. All our elementary particles, they are Weyl fermions. And they are described by either this or with minus sign. This means that they are left-handed. And now in momentum space, P, momentum P, locks as a quantization axis for spin, Pauli matrix for spin sigma. That's why for each direction of P, spin sigma should be directed along P. And that's why one has the hedgehog. And of course, one can write, of course, the invariant in terms of the chair number. Instead of considering just relativistic case, we consider general case, sigma does dot g, the vector field in momentum space. And then there is a chair number, the integral around, on the surface around this hedgehog. And this chair number gives you plus 1 for the right-handed particles and minus 1 for left-handed particles. And since these particles are topologically stable, then this is the reason why we still alive, because of topological property of the Weyl fermions. So all the elementary particles, U quark, neutrino, left neutrino, right neutrino, right electron, d quark, right and left. So they are either hedgehog with spins or spines outward, or hedgehog with spin or spines inward. These are left-handed particles. This is Chern number written on top of the Green's function. Okay, and in helium 3a we have just two Weyl particles, two Weyl points here, and close. So the spectrum is rather non-relativistic. It's absolutely non-relativistic, but close to this point, they become completely relativistic. So they are described just by this equation. So gamma matrices, it is Pauli matrices. P k naught is the position of the node. It can be either here or here. And this matrix, it plays the role of the tetrad field, because the square of the tetrad field gives you the G-menu. So helium 3 demonstrate how the correct general relativity appears, general relativity in terms of the tetrad field and not in terms of the G-menu. Because this guy obtained when you take square of that, and then the square of tetrad gives you the effective metric.
Could you explain again what the capital gamma I is?
It's sigma Pauli, sorry.
Ah, okay.
Yes. 2 by 2 matrix.
Points like complex one points or they're there?
No, no, they're well. Ah, no, no. Of course, the yes, this is a superconductor, and that's why. Just what is the direction? Yes, this guy is completely Weyl particle.